Hello! You're watching this video series about Qt containers in Qt 5 and 6. I am Giuseppe D'Angelo. In this video, we are going to discuss which one to use, the Qt containers or the standard library containers. Before we get started, let me just put a disclaimer here. That is, I understand that this topic is highly controversial and highly polarizing, and we live in a world which is polarized enough so that I don't want to add more to that. The following is just my personal consideration after years and years and years of developing Qt applications, of developing Qt itself, and so what I personally think you should do when it comes to deciding whether to use a Qt container or a standard library container. Your approach, your feelings may come from different backgrounds, and you may be totally agreeing with me or also totally disagreeing with me. But that's fine. This is a technical matter, so I'm just going to judge it on its technical merits. And you may find that my personal trade-offs are not the same as your personal trade-offs. Again, that's perfectly fine as long as each other realize that we're talking about trade-offs. We're talking about nothing is perfect, nothing is completely broken. This is just different ways, different approaches to the same matter. So, when it comes to which ones to use, let me list to you why you should use the Qt containers or why you shouldn't use the Qt containers. And let me do it in the other way around. So I'm just first going to tell you good reasons not to use the Qt containers today, and then I'm going to give you some reason to use the Qt containers today. To me, the biggest reason not to use a Qt container today is this one, is that the fact that Qt containers have way too few complexity and behavioral guarantees. Qt changes things from time to time. Typically, that happens only on major upgrades, so when you go from Qt 5 to Qt 6, but sometimes it also happens within the same major version, because some behavior is found to be not good, not ideal, or in contrast with something else, or incoherent, or whatnot, and so decided to change some behavior. And generally speaking, there is nothing wrong with changing behavior. Anything is a behavior change. A bug fix is a behavior change. But containers have this peculiarity, that is, they are low-level building blocks. And since they are low-level building blocks, it is way too easy to actually rely on these semantics, rely on these complexity guarantees or behavioral guarantees a little bit all over the place, especially in algorithmic related code. So when you're writing some code which is, I don't know, running over a vector and performing operations on it and changing the order of elements and whatnot, you may be writing code with some idea in your mind about, okay, these operations cost me that much and that much. And if Qt comes along and changes some of these costs, then everything you did may get undone, right? Because Qt may just change the complexity of some operation, which was maybe cost on time and make it linear or whatever, and all of a sudden your code, which was assuming something, becomes much worse. While this sounds pretty theoretical, the thing is, this is real in software engineering. In software engineering, it is just too easy to depend on any aspect of an API. This is formalized. It's called Hyrum's Law. Look it up. I'm going to leave a link down in the description. But eventually, any sort of behavior from the container classes, since they are so low level, is relied upon somewhere. And changing it for any reason, even the best reason, is typically harmful to somebody. And whether that's good or whether that's bad, I don't know. I'm mostly on, this is a bad part. Mostly it's a bad part on my side because Qt never actually formalizes much about its own containers. Since so much is undocumented, Qt kind of floats in this middle ground where, you know what, I didn't promise this operation had these costs. I didn't promise this operation had these invariants. So let me change these costs. Let me change these invariants because there was never a contract between us. And from time to time, this results in annoying things that break down and you don't understand why, or in some piece of code which all of a sudden regresses complexity. This is for me the biggest reason not to use Qt containers. As you can see, it's a bigger reason than the Qt containers are missing this specific API, which I really like, or, you know, I don't like camel case, I prefer snake case. Those are, you know, minor. Those are not really that important to me. To me, the stability promise is the promise. Again, especially in such low-level code, so low-level building blocks. And breaking them from time to time, even from time to time, may become unacceptable. Then, if you really want to start nitpicking on the API, yes, there are various things about the Qt containers and standard library containers. On one side, the standard library containers are faster and way more tested. The reason why they're faster is simple. It's because these days, the standard library containers come from the same people who give you the compiler. So if you're using GCC, you're likely using the GNU C++ standard library. If you're using Clang LLVM, you're using libc++. If you're using Microsoft, you're using the Microsoft STL, and so on. And so compiler and standard library typically go hand in hand, and compiler vendors know how to optimize the standard library quite well so that it gets as fast as it can get, and that makes perfect sense. Similarly, since the C++ user base is at least one order of magnitude bigger than the Qt user base, you can be pretty sure that the people using standard vector are at least one order of magnitude more than the people using QVector. So that code is way more tested, way more inspected, and so on. And yes, rightfully, the standard library containers have more features than the Qt containers. So things like support for move-only types, that simply doesn't exist in the Qt containers, it's in the standard library. Exception safety, if exceptions are your thing, then Qt containers are simply not exception safe at all. While the standard library containers are tested for exception safety, they have a precise exception contract. Several other APIs are still missing from Qt containers, things like range insertion, all the node-based APIs for associative containers is missing, heterogeneous lookup in sorted associative containers and unsorted associative containers is missing, and so on and so forth. But really, I consider these minor things from a certain point of view. Okay, sure, it would be nice to have them, especially move-only data types. It would be really nice to have that particular feature inside Qt containers. But I can live without that if only everything else was super solid, super strong. And unfortunately, that is not always the case. So that's my take on this. But what are the good sides, though? Right? There must be a good trade-off. Well, I can tell you, yes, there are good trade-offs. The big advantage to me of using Qt containers is the easier to use Nazar API. Undoubtedly, having things like contains, having things like index of, etc. inside a container is so much more convenient than having to resort to an algorithm all the time. Sure, I understand that the standard library is designed that way for very good reasons. I'm just saying that this convenience, this nicer to use, nice looking API has also its benefits when it comes to everyday programming. I mean, the point of writing code for the majority of programmers is not to have some perfected idea of what C++ should be. Their job is to write code. The job is to get the job done. And so not putting obstacles in their way is definitely a good thing. And Qt achieves this quite well, I would say. So that's why the Qt containers themselves are quite popular. That, of course, comes with pros and cons. That is this all extra convenience really worth it? So would you buy Qt just for this? Would you buy into Qt containers just for this? That, I don't know. Okay, that is pretty much, it's hard to say whether the convenience is worth it. And also, please sharing, knowing whether that is worth it or not, this, you know, the defining feature of Qt containers, implicit sharing. Sure, before move semantics, this was very important to have, but with move semantics in the language, do we really still need it? How many times do we keep copies of containers and we rely on them to be shallow? That is a very hard question. I don't think that is actually used in practice, except for a few exceptional cases, and I would rather not have it in the I would rather not have it today in today's Qt, but I understand that Qt can never move away from it without breaking a lot of code. And surely, code like Qt, code that comes with a very strong binary compatibility promise, will find implicit sharing an extremely nice feature, because it allows you to return things by value, even if you're returning a copy of something, right? That copy is cheap to do, it's cheap to make, and so you can live with that. If instead you had to change signatures of your functions from returning values to returning references or anything like that, that has an impact on your binary compatibility, and so Qt cannot just do it. And so Qt finds its own hands tied by the promise, which means that Qt needs an alternative way of cheaply returning value objects by value, and that way is, of course, implicit sharing. And so in conclusion, which one should you use? Consider also this, that for many important metrics, the standard library containers are actually better than the Qt containers. When it comes to code speed, or when it comes to speed or code size or things like that, the standard library containers actually perform better than Qt containers. And for this reason, if you peek inside Qt's source code, you will find that standard library containers are used a little bit all over the place. That's because Qt knows that when there is no promise of binary compatibility or stuff like that, a standard vector will typically perform better than a Q vector. And so that's when Qt starts using those containers instead. In other containers, this is still done internally. For instance, Qmap and Qmultimap in Qt sticks actually just wrap a standard map and a standard multimap. That's because it makes no sense for Qt to reinvent a binary search tree when there is a perfectly usable one coming from standard library. Now, this doesn't mean that Qt will simply drop all of its own containers. That doesn't happen. Qt containers are still exposed at the API level in Qt. So if you have, there's plenty of functions in Qt that take a QList or return a QList, and that's not going to change because Qt has a very strong API and ABI compatibility promise. Although finding a solution to this problem, that is how to avoid exposing container classes from APIs, is indeed an interesting challenge, something that it's actively being researched. There isn't a perfect solution just yet. There are various degrees of approximation. Don't worry about this, because Qt is not going to break all of your code just to say, okay, tomorrow we're ditching Qt containers, just use the standard library containers. And in a nutshell, at least according to me, applications should do the same. Applications should prefer the standard library containers in their as general purpose containers, use Qt containers only when there isn't an equivalent one coming from the standard library or coming maybe from Boost or Abseil or other third-party libraries. And this is very unlikely, because if it's not in the standard library, you can be pretty sure it's in one of the major C++ libraries out there. But still, keep using Qt containers when interfacing with Qt itself or when writing Qt-based code. Again, avoid converting containers back and forth from a Q vector to a standard vector when in one direction, from a standard vector to a Q vector in the other direction. That makes no sense. You can just use the Q vector and that's done. And that's it. I hope I clarified what I think about this whole Qt versus standard library dilemma. But please feel free to comment below if you think otherwise. As I said, I'm not claiming that I have the absolute truth. This is just my personal take after years and years and years of working on this. Your experience may be slightly different than mine, or maybe just working in a different industry than the ones that I work with. And so your vision of the world may be very different, but that's good. That's good to have. That's good to hear more voices. There is nothing which is absolute perfection. There is nothing which is an absolute disaster. Things can coexist. We just have to find a good trade-off for each one of us. So thank you very much for watching. And as usual, have a good day.